Hey everybody, you're watching Marvel Live from San Diego Comic-Con 2018, and we're here with Chris Anka, artist of the millennium. I'm obsessed with your work. Of the millennium.
That sets it up. All right.
Let's talk about Runaways, because it's pretty much all I want to do when I talk about comics.
Okay, that's good.
I know that you and Rainbow Rowell work together very closely.
Yeah.
How many outfits have been in Runaways now? Because I know you care about the fashion.
Oh, man. Let's say on average, if everyone gets an outfit per issue, we've had 11 issues so far. What is that? We 6 kids, 70. One issue, I think I had 30 outfit changes. So we're going to probably say around 90 to 100 already in just the first two arcs.
So cosplayers.
Yeah, no, like it's all there for you.
Do a full collection.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, they're pretty easy to spell. I mean, most of it's on Pinterest, so it should be pretty easy to find.
The run is so phenomenal. I love talking to Rainbow about working together with you. What is it like collaborating between the two of you?
It's a lot of fun. We have a running joke that we're always in the middle of a conversation. Like, it always feels like that. There's almost no decision made on the book that we both don't do. Mm-hmm. Especially when with Arc 1 was already written before I kind of came on board, mm-hmm. but with Arc 2, we've been basically talking about everything together the entire time. I'll pitch outfits to her. I'll pitch panels. I mean, we kind of like everything kind of goes back and forth, and she's very involved in every stage of the process. And then I get to be involved with the very early stuff that's plotting and all that, and then it's really nice, but still, because what we talk about and then actually seeing it in the script is really crazy to see. Like, oh man, I remember that from 8 months ago when we talked about this.
Yeah.
I mean, there's stuff that happened in issue 11 that we've been talking about since before I drew issue 1.
Right.
And so it's like it's been a lot of fun kind of seeing it rewarded and these like little ideas that we had together rather than just being someone who gets scripts month in, month out and not really knowing what's going to happen.
It sounds like an awesome collaboration.
It's kind of been my favorite.
So you talked a little bit about the fashion. What is the importance? Speak about that, the importance of fashion in your storytelling and with the artwork and stuff like that. It's just because fashion, the fact that there are outfit changes within a comic book is kind of pretty awesome and kind of new and fun.
I mean, one thing was that it helps show time,
mm-hmm.
Especially with a book that is kind of slow and kind of about them as people, especially because they have no costumes.
Mm.
So there's nothing I can really fall back on that is a specific look for them or the time and true. So I need to be able to show, especially with issue 5, that's the one with the, I think Molly has 7 outfits herself in that one issue, because we needed to show that a week has passed.
Mm-hmm.
So she's not going to be wearing the same stuff every week, especially, you know, she's living at home with her grandmother, she's going to be wanting to do laundry. I needed to be able to show that and show change. And it also tells a story. Can we talk about spoilers for Arc 1?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I think that's fair. You guys should be caught up. If you're not, go get it together and get on it.
Loose spoilers.
Gentle spoilers.
Because Arc 1 is dealing with Gert coming back and not really knowing where she's fitting. And so clothes played into it where she doesn't know who she is anymore, so her clothing weren't hers. Mm-hmm. She was wearing hand-me-downs, mm-hmm. Chase's hand-me-downs, or the grandmother's hand-me-downs. And that kind of helped. You know, every piece of clothing is part of design. Every decision you make is part of design, and it all tells the story. So we were able to tell that Gert doesn't feel comfortable in her skin yet by physically putting her in clothes that aren't hers. And kind of having that sort of develop over time. And it also just allows us to have fun. I'm not drawing the same hair all the time.
Yeah.
You know, every issue, Chase is changing up his hair. Carolina's changing up her hair. And it just kind of makes it more interesting rather than the same boring haircut day in and day out, and you don't know if this took a day or a month in between issues.
How much time has passed in this?
Yeah, exactly.
Same day? Yeah, exactly. That's
where do you find inspiration for outfits and wardrobes? Like, I don't know, I live in New York, I feel like everybody just puts the black thing on and wears the black thing, and then they get on
that's
the subway,
New York, yeah.
And
yeah.
They wear off in black.
What I looked at with Runaways was the fact that I grew up in LA, so a story about teenagers that grew up between 2007 and 2018 is really easy. You know, I started high school the same, like, 2 months that Runaway started, like, originally started. So I was exactly their age group. So I knew all these kids. Like, I literally went to school with a Carolina and a Nico and a Victor. So when being taxed with it, of just knowing how do I translate their 2007 look to 2018, I didn't really need to look that hard. I remember there was a Twitter comment that was razzing me for putting Carolina in a white romper, and brown sandals.
I love that picture.
And then I literally sat outside for not 2 minutes, and I saw a blonde woman in a white romper and brown sandals walk by me. I'm like, there she is. So it's like with that, it's like I know all of their distinctive looks, you know, especially I think with Rainbow and I, we grew up on them. So we already know who they are. So I know how to dress them rather than I'm not really searching for them anymore. So it makes it kind of easy. And then just also a lot of time. Like I spend a lot of time on Pinterest just pulling things, pulling wardrobes. So I have options.
Wow.
Like I spent a month just building wardrobes for all of them. And then I spend a day per issue building an outfit, even if it's just one off. So I know how that issue is going to feel and what's going to happen in that issue and how many changes there are in that issue, because I need it to feel like actual kids. It's like important that they feel their age and not just running around in the same thing day in and day out.
Well, and along those lines, I think this is, I mean, maybe because I'm so emotionally attached to Runaways, because I have the same thing of kind of growing with that. Like, I feel like this is some of the most emotional work I've seen of yours.
There's a whole lot of crying.
But there's that beautiful moment between Carolina and Nico where it's kind of like keeps going back to Nico and she blushes. And it tells such a huge part of the story, even though it's like very subtle changes.
There was I think it was issue 3 when they finally meet Carolina in college and they have that whole scene with Nico and Carolina. Mm. And the entire time, Nico won't look at her.
Mm-hmm.
This entire conversation, so that we save the moment when they do actually look at each other, that is it's like a period in that conversation just between their acting.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of emoting, and it's a lot of what's not being said or what the words that are coming out and how does that relate to what they're thinking. Because there's a lot of detail in Rainbow's paragraphs of the panel breakdowns, and a lot of it is just what they're thinking. And it's not what they're saying, because I need to know the words don't necessarily have to match what they're feeling, but I need to show what they're feeling rather than what they're saying. So that's kind of my job. So it blends in. So there's like two layers of emotion for every single panel.
I mean, something you just said like blew my mind. I feel like I'm literally sitting here like, because I had this realization that, so when you work with Rainbow, Rainbow's sort of like the director and you really get to be the actor in all of these pieces and make the whole cast acting decisions. I mean, do you really sit there and think about, okay, emotional journey, here's what they mean, here's the truth?
Yeah, it's definitely like, it's a mix between actor and a cinematographer.
Right, yeah.
And like, Rainbow gives me, like, this is the blueprint.
Right.
I'm like, okay, well then this is how we're gonna play that.
Right.
There's a whole lot of like, just emotional through lines that we have to connect and a lot of it is silent.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of it is heartbreaking, because like when I'm drawing it, I'll get into like that mood. So a lot of stuff with Victor is like really, really heartbreaking.
Oh,
and like I'll
get
like really into it, and I'm just like I'm like almost crying. Mm-hmm. So I'm like I'm scrunching my face to make that face, and then I can feel it all happening. Especially in 12. 12 is a rough one.
Yeah.
Like I think there's more crying in 12 than I think I've ever drawn in my entirety at Marvel.
But there's also, I will say, there's a lot of joy too, because you get to have evil cats.
Hey. Yeah, the cats are a lot of fun.
A legion of evil grandma cats.
Well, it's like you always have these like really, really intense emotional beats, and then there's Old Lace in the background being like this giant puppy who just wants to eat food. Like, she's a lot of fun. Like, Old Lace is a lot of fun because it's that like joy. You know, you see those photos of dogs who don't realize how big they are?
Yeah.
And they're sitting in people's laps, but like they're just like, I just want to be here, and everyone's like suffocating. And it's kind of Old Lace in a room all the time. Yeah. She's just like, I'm here, and I'm just trying to be on people, and like have her hanging on people or lying on someone's legs. It's just a lot of fun.
And when they're finally reunited, Gert and Old Lace, it's just
that was the first real, issue 1 was a lot of, you know, hit the ground running, and there's a lot of emotions, and we're getting back into it. But it really didn't kind of feel like, oh, this is the Runaways, until I drew the page of Old Lace and Gert. And realizing this is like the first time they've been, like, and someone, I remember someone tweeted, I think it was in issue 6 when we finally have them all lined up, like, this is the first time they've been together in like 8 years. Like, that cast, like the Victor and the, because Gert's been gone for so long, and to kind of finally have that reunion again, it's kind of a weird journey, honestly.
Yeah.
Speaking of tweets, we have fan questions.
All right, let's do it.
Yeah.
All right. Did you use a model reference for your Star-Lord? Question. And if so, does that fine man have an Instagram asking for ellipsis
artistic reasons.
Uh-huh. Yeah, but yeah, sure. there wasn't actually. I don't think so.
You do draw some very brawny, yeah, very attractive gentlemen.
I don't think there was a specific guy for Peter. I think it was just sort of. I think I took a little of Chris Pratt, and then I kind of took is it mixed that with like sort of the Sarah Pacelli, Valeria Skeeti, Star Lord, and I kind of just combined that into what became that hunk.
I like that. Yeah, there's another one. Is there any character that you enjoy the most drawing, and how is your creative process? P.S. I'm a big fan. Smiley face. Thank you.
Thank you. let's just make it simple. On Runaways, it's Carolina. Carolina's the most fun, I think, because I know Carolina the most, and she gives me a lot, the most visual. I can be the most expressive with her. I can change her up. She's got the kind of the most leniency. Well, not leniency. Like I can play with her, like her hair a lot. I can play with her clothes a lot more than anyone else. So she's always the most fun and the most I can experiment with. Mm-hmm. There, that's the word.
I like that. Yeah. I like the cool experimentation with like seeing those characters. Yeah.
I think because it's on a cover, but like with Carolina, I give Carolina a hair bow. Mm-hmm. In 12, and like that's something I can't do with anyone else, but like it's such a fun idea that she's got all this weight, mm-hmm, because of her power, that I can really have a lot of material to work with her.
Nice. Back to fashion, someone wants to know, they say, I know the outfits you put together for Runaways are important to you. What are your favorite designers you look at for inspiration? Mm-hmm. And then I also want to know, like, you ever think maybe like you should just make your own line? Because like everybody's raving about the fashion. Like, I mean, I don't know what it takes to start up, like Etsy or something, man.
Maybe, hopefully. there's no specific designer, because who these kids are, I don't think they can buy designer labels. So a lot of with Runaways, it's more that I'm more like a stylist than a designer, where I'm picking pieces I can find and kind of building a wardrobe that feels like them. So if anyone wants help picking a wardrobe, that I can do.
There we go. Hey. Go over. Pick out some clothes, hang out.
Yeah, send me options and I'll kind of like build it for you.
That's my dream. That's all I want.
I want a personal, how would you rate the fashion here at Comic-Con? How like, I know it's an eclectic mix of people.
Do we want to talk about this, really?
I mean, all the good stuff. Yeah. I mean, cosplay, of course, have you seen some really cool outfits? Like, yeah.
I haven't been on the floor that much, but there's always fantastic cosplays. But it's also really hot. So sure. I don't think anyone's really dressing to impress here. I think we're just like dressing for comfort and air.
Yes, I mean, for survival.
Yeah.
It's a lot of comic book t-shirts.
Yeah. I think I know everyone's into comic
this,
books. Yeah.
A lot of this
as you
and
can
this.
Tell.
Yeah.
The highest fashion I go is like the 3/4 length sleeve.
It's nice. It's a nice look. You know, you don't commit to the full. It's not one long collar for your whole arm. It's on a t-shirt. You kind of play it up a little bit.
Thank you.
It's
see?
Very nice.
I need that an appraisal. I want to make sure that I'm at least killing it somewhat here, yeah, at the convention. Yeah.
It's good.
Is thank the hat too much?
No. Oh. No, it works.
All right. Well, join the conversation with hashtag Marvel SDCC.
Nailed it. Amazing. So I have a question for you. So you have a lot of couples. You've written a lot of sort of couple-y books. You've worked with Rogue and Gambit. We've seen your work with Peter and all of that. Who's your favorite ship of all time? Ooh, your Marvel ship?
Are we talking just in comics?
In Marvel Comics, let's go.
Oh man!
I think our first Comic Con, the first Comic Con I met you, I did ask you for a commission of Elsa and Iceman, which exists in my
that's
home to this
great.
Day.
That does exist. Yep. I think that's how we met.
You
commissioned me for that. I was a Scott Emma guy.
Yeah.
I was very much a Scott Emma guy. Yeah. I like the play off those two. I like that Emma was able to kind of see the drive in Scott and kind of like help bring that, and then I think Scott kind of helped bring some humanity back to Emma and kind of like how to slow down, because I think you know, we always think of Emma as just such a shrewd and intense woman, mm-hmm, and we always forget that Emma first and foremost is a teacher and that she wants to help people, yeah, although she may be a bit blunt about it, mm-hmm, and I think kind of Scott is really good at kind of helping soften those edges, mm-hmm. And then she's able to like make Scott kind of kick him out of the bed a bit, like mm-hmm, let's go. So I always kind of love that kind of powered couple.
Now I look at them differently.
Oh, I, yeah. It's one of my favorites as well. So
good, yes.
I like it.
Very good one.
I always go Scott Phoenix, but you know. Disagree.
Yeah.
We'll never solve it.
I mean, who do you think? I want to know who do you think is the most fashionable hero in all of Marvel? Who do you think, like, not even just in costume? Who do you think is the one
who
that, like, always? Hey, that person's always killing it every time you see them.
There's a lot of characters.
Mm-hmm.
Probably in a weird way, Thor.
Really?
Thor's always killing because he can wear whatever.
That's true.
Yeah, he can wear anything.
Thor can wear whatever. He is fashion. Whatever he puts on works.
It's like he fills out every outfit so well.
Yeah, exactly.
No matter how big it is, what small, he will fill it out.
It could be a suit. It could be a rag. He pulls it off.
I like that.
I would say Aurora and T'Challa.
Those two are also really good. I do miss the mohawk.
I mean, honestly, Aurora in anything, and she's killing it. You know, the punk mohawk, or I always remember the House of M red dress she's wearing when she's trying it out. Like, she's always killing it.
Oh yeah, and the wedding.
Yeah.
The wedding is like.
Yeah, no. She's always flawless. Yeah.
You're clutching, it's like, ooh. Yeah. So, I think T'Challa's also fashionable too. Yeah, you're right.
One question before we wrap it up here. It says, personal life reportedly spends all his time drawing and going to cons. And so that's reportedly. Can you confirm or deny? And then we can just erase the reportedly part.
I want to know who's making this report.
I have no idea.
In theory, I don't do that many conventions anymore. I mean, there's a lot of drawings and just sitting outside staring at clouds. And Pinterest, a lot of Pinterest.
Because you're dealing with all the emotions of the
road. Yeah, exactly. I need to re-examine myself. Yeah, but a lot of time drawing. A lot of time drawing.
Word.
Well, thank you so much for talking with us today. Where can people find you online and that kind of stuff?
Just at Christopher Anka on Twitter and Instagram.
Awesome.
Pretty easy.
Well, thank you so much for talking with us, you guys. Special
thanks
to our live stream sponsor, Hyundai.